أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء وخاتم المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا بالقاسم محمد. ولا على بيته الطيبين الطاهر المعصومين واللانة الدائمة الباقي لأعدائهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين. أما بعد، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ألف لام ميم، ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين. With the blessings of the holy month of Ramadan, we got the opportunity to go through the brief review of Surah Rahman, Surah number 55 of the Quran. It's a surah where almost two-thirds of the surah deals with the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is indicated by the first word of the surah, Ar-Rahman, reflecting the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Till now, you know, we saw a list of many, many things in the heavens and the earth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described as the blessings and things that He has created so that human life can be sustainable on this planet. Then all of a sudden, and this is the beauty of the approach that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has, He talks about what He has created for us, you know, major signs of His power and glory. Then all of a sudden He comes to the point where He says, كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فَانْ. I've done everything for you, but remember, you are not going to live here forever. Everyone, the living, you know, the jinn and ins on this earth, they are going to die one day. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to make us realize, that this dunya is a place where we build our akhirah. So do not be, absorbed into the beauty of this dunya to the extent that you forget the akhirah. And He also then made us realize that there is a day of judgment where He is going to be in full control. It's not that because He's every day doing something, so He will be busy and He will not be able to, hold us accountable for our deeds. No, He is fully aware, fully in control, and He is Rabbul Alameen in the true sense of the word. As a way of reforming and making us realize that what we have to do for the Akhirah, two methods were used. One was the scenery of Jahannam and what happens to those who are bad people, the evil ones. And then we came to the last part of the surah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then talks about the positive element, that if you follow My commandments, these are the rewards that I have for you in the Jannah. What we saw yesterday was basically the beginning of the description of Jannah, especially, you know, going to this ayat, وَلِمَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ جَنَّتَانَ, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about those who have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not because they believe Allah is, na'uzu billahi, a monster to be feared, but this fear is based on different levels. People, you know, have that khawf on a different level. One is those who realize His rububiyyat, that He is the absolute Lord, and He is worthy of being obeyed, and we have to stay away from disobedience. And then He talked about the things that He has reserved for them. Yesterday we looked at about four or five things. One was, He said, the people who fear the maqam rabbihi, you know, they shall have two gardens. And then both those gardens would have abundance in the trees and the branches. Two flowing streams, we looked at the ayat yesterday. And also a pair of every fruit. And finally, let me make a comment about the a pair of every fruit. One of the explanations that we see in Tafasir is that, you know, the fruits will be of two types. One, those with which we are familiar in this dunya, And other would be a similar, you know, fruit, but unlike what we see in this dunya. And reclining on beds, and the fruits would be very, you know, easily reachable to us. When we looked at this ayat yesterday about reclining on the beds, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had a description there where he says, you know, the beds would have lining of, what was the statement? Huh? Silk, green silk. Okay, you remember that. Good. The point is, Allah didn't talk about what will be the cover of the bed. The lining is inside. You know, like what we call astar. Always the material which is up there is of a better quality than what is, you know, inside. And Allah only talks about the lining inside. He has left us to dream about what will be on the top. Okay, so that's again one way of trying to just create that excitement about what he has for us in the Jannah, inshallah. To continue that, you know, all these five items that we see, these are basically material rewards that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has reserved for those لِمَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ جَنَّتَانِ. But then, to continue that, and this is the ayat we are looking at it tonight, ayat number 56, to continue this discussion. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about something very different. Looking at the nature of the human being, Allah knows that all these good things that I mentioned, which is good, but I have created the human being, and I know that companionship is the most important thing. You know, even if you look at Adam alayhi salam, Allah created him and he was there as a guest of Allah in Jannah. Where it was, it's not a more point of discussion here. And, you know, and I'm not reading an ayat of Quran, it's just paraphrasing the whole scenery there. It seems that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala realized, you know, Adam has everything here, but still he looks like he's lonely. And that is where Allah says, okay, I'll create Hawa for you, so that you have a companion. So this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us. And he is continuing that process in the akhirah also. And so after all these material goods, then he talks about it and he says, in those Jannah, the gardens that he is going to give, in them are maidens of restrained glances whom no man or jinn has touched before. Now, restrained glances, with what does that mean? قاصرات الطرف. طرف means, you know, the glances. And قاصرات means restrained. And that actually means that these will be the women who are, or the whore, who totally dedicate themselves to their husbands. And this is actually a point for us, because when we look at this issue, you know, casting down the glances, this is a serious problem for us in this dunya. And we are told even in the akhirah, one of the man virtue would be the same thing. And it's not only a dunyawi issue, it's also a ukhrawi issue, and this is a sign of modesty. You know, if you look at the Quran, in Surah An-Nur, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about hijab, in that entire passage where he talks about hijab, the first ayat addresses the men. It's later on the second ayat talks about women, where the Prophet is told, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ, say to the believing men that they should cast down their eyes, and then the ayat goes on. And then the following ayah says, وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ, and say to the believing women. So the ayat of hijab is there. The method of hijab is different for men and women. But the ayat addresses mu'mineen first and then mu'minat later on. What we forget is that although the women are required to have this hijab of the kind of the garment, You know, but both men and women have another hijab which is there all the time. And that is the hijab of eyes, to cast down our glances. And that is the most difficult one. And although, you know, and because it is there all the time, maybe the eyelid is there. It's just, you know, just close your eyes. This is the parda that we have for our eyes. And this is an issue which we, you know, see even the world suffering from this in different at different levels. And we are not only talking about the issue, the modern technology has also created many, many problems. And so this issue of the controlling the glances of the eyes, what we see. And that is where Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam when he says, when you fast, it's not only the fasting of the food and drink, it's the fasting of the limbs. That's what it means when he's talking about fasting of the limbs. And further, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, now this often repeated ayat comes in. It will come today about 7 times. فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. Our response is, لَا بِشَيْءٍ مِنْ آلَائِكَ رَبِّي أُكَذِّبْ. Continuing this, you know, blessing of companionship in the Jannah, then he says, you know, not only that, they will be chaste and modest, not touched by anyone. كَأَنَّهُمْ الْيَاقُوتُ وَالْمَرْجَانِ. He is using human, you know, standards of beauty. He says they will be as if they are, you know, made of rubies and coral. Rubies are red, coral is white. It's so basically a mixture of that. You would have a, you know, beautiful color, and even the, you know, all the physical beauty that we are talking about will come there together. But the important thing we have to note is that in ayat number 56, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even when he talks about the women in the akhirah, he talked about their modesty first, and then he talks about their beauty in this ayat 58. This is again an indication to us that when we talk about preference in our relationships, when we talk about marriage, you know, the preference comes for akhlaq number one, and physical beauty is later on. So even the criteria that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about, the hur or the women who will be in Jannah, there also akhlaq and modesty comes first. Physical beauty, that they are like al-ya'qud wal-marjan, comes secondary. We'll talk about this inshallah tomorrow also, because whenever we talk about it, we get complaints from the ladies. What will happen to us? So we'll leave that, you know, question unanswered until tomorrow, inshallah. We'll talk about it in more detail, because then an ayat is coming again about it at the end of this surah. فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ لَا بِشَيْءٍ مِنْ آلَائِكَ رَبِّي أُكَذِّبْ. At this juncture, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way concludes this part of, you know, blessing those who are good people, especially the category of the people who are man khafa maqama rabbihi, who are khaifeen. And Allah ends by saying, hal jazaa'ul ihsan illa al-ihsan. All these good things that I have described about the people who have khawf, the reward for them in the akhirah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says this is based on a universal principle that he has created for us. And what is that? Hal jazaa'ul ihsan illa al-ihsan. If somebody does good to you. The word ihsan here is not exactly in the way it's used in Urdu, for example. Here, ihsan is from husn, and husn means something good. It can be applied to a person as well as an action. So anyone does a good deed to you, he is a muhsin. He is a doer of good to you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here basically is teaching us the lesson that if somebody is good to you, you also should be good to him in return. Of course, there is no comparison between human beings and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, when we become khaif, we are being good by following the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah says, I'll reward you. Of course, he rewards the good doers more than what they deserve. So, you know, it's not really a comparison of that kind. But this is a universal issue. We have a hadith from our sixth Imam, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq. In a statement which has been quoted by Ali bin Salim, where he says that I heard the Imam talking about an ayat. He said that there is an ayat in Quran which is of a universal nature. And he says, I asked him, ma hiya, which is that ayat? And Imam recited the same ayat, hal jaza al ihsan illa al ihsan. And then he says, jara fil kafir wal mu'min wal bir wal fasiq. This ayat and its application of this moral teaching of if somebody has done ihsan to you, you do ihsan to him in return. This applies to everyone, whether he is a kafir or a mu'min, or a good doer or a fasiq. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, when we talk about interaction with one another, even if they are people of other faith, you know, when it comes, if somebody has done a favor to you, they have been good to you, you have to be good to them in return also. Of course, Imam says you can never be equal, because the person who initiated that will always have an upper hand over you, because you are just rewarding him or repaying his ihsan and goodness. And so the fadilat is with the one who initiated the process. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself, when he talks about hal jaza al ihsan illa al ihsan, he does not even leave the non-Muslims, the non-believers alone on this matter either. Those who do good deeds, even though they do not recognize him, they do not believe in him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would reward them for their good deeds, either in this dunya or by lessening the adhab for them in Jahannam. Because Jannah is, the condition is iman. And this is where, just one ayat for you from Surah Isra, Surah number 17, ayat 18, which says, مَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ الْعَاجِلَ عَجَّلْنَا لَهُ فِيهَا مَا نَشَاءُ لِمَنْ نُرِيدُ. Whoever seeks the compensation or reward immediately in this dunya, عَجَّلْنَا لَهُ فِيهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we will respond to that desire that they have. They do good, we will give them the reward in this dunya. Of course, still Allah says, مَا نَشَاءُ لِمَن نُرِيدُ. Still the control is absolutely in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then he says, ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَا لَهُ جَهَنَّمَا يَصْلَاهَا مَظْلُومًا مَدْحُورًا. After I have rewarded him for his good deeds in the dunya, in the akhirah, he's going to go to the Jahannam, while he will be regretting what happened to him. And so even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it comes to good deeds, he rewards even those who do not recognize him in this dunya, either through wealth or health or security or fame in this dunya. So these are different ways that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compensates the non-believers for their good deeds in this dunya. And as if you know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after this ayat that I taught you this principle, so again, it's a blessing. فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. So which of your Lord's bounties will you both deny? And the response is, لَا بِشَيْءٍ مِنْ آلَائِكَ رَبِّي أُكَذِّبْ. This was all about this ayat number 46. لِمَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ. For the category of those believers who are khaifin, who are on that level where they have khawf in their heart because of the maqam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah talks about another category of believers who will be in Jannah. وَمِن دُونِهِمَا جَنَّتَانِ. He talked about the Jannah which has two gardens for those who have khawf. Now he talks about the second class. Still in Jannah, still in a very, very good situation, but they are not on the level of khaifin. They are on the second level. وَمِن دُونِهِمَا. And you have those two gardens there, then this level beneath that, there will be two other gardens. And when you look at this, basically the comparison would be that in the first ayat, we're talking about مقربين, السابقون السابقون. And they basically, what they will have would be just classified as جنة الرضوان, this pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be the main thing for them. This ayat basically is talking about the second level of Ashabul Yameen. You know, in Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala divides people into three groups. As-sabiqoon, as-sabiqoon, al-muqarribun. Then you have Ashabul Yameen, again, who are on a good side. And then you have Ashabul Shimal, who are going to go to Jahannam. And so that second level would be applicable to Ashabul Yameen. And these are the people who are also good doers, and their Jannah is known as Jannatul Na'im. Just to explain this slightly differently, you know, yesterday I recited this hadith from Amir al-Mu'mineen where he says that the worshippers are of three kinds. There is a group of people who do ibadatul abid because of the fear of the fire of Jahannam. They worship him. And so this is the worship of the slaves. The second category is of those who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because they have this desire and love for the good things in the Jannah. And so Amir al-Mu'minin describes that as ibadatul tujjar. This is the worship of the merchants who always look for something in return. And then he says the third category is of those who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because they consider him to be worthy of being worshipped. And this is ibadatul ahrar. This is the worship of those who are truly free people, who are not shackled by the dunya wa ma fiha. And so you can say that the first one, liman khafa maqam rabbihi, refers to the third category, those who worship Allah for the sake of his lordship. And the second category, the second level would apply to those who do ibadat out of the fear of Jahannam or for the desire of Jannah. And again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ لَا بِشَيْءٍ مِنْ آلَائِكَ رَبِّي أُكَذِّبْ. Describing this Jannah, the two gardens of the second level in Jannah, goes on further where he says, مُدْحَمَّتَان. It means dark green. These gardens would be dark green or densely shaded. It's the same thing, but when you look at it from different perspective, you give a different meaning to it. Especially if you look at the jungle or the forest from far away, it would look more dark, but the closer you go, you will actually see the colors. And so that's how, you know, the translations are done in different way from different perspective. Basically, it's talking about the density of the gardens that the people would have there, whether they are muqarribin or the second group, and the freshness of the trees in those two gardens. This is the shortest verse of the Quran. Okay, this is for the question, remember. If you ask which is the shortest verse of the Quran, which consists of only one word, is this. Surah number 55, ayat 64. And the longest ayat of the Quran is in Surah Baqarah, ayat number 282. فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ.